Blackstone presents The Butcher by Laura Cat Young. This book is read by Amanda Dolan. For Violet, Ilsa, and James, I love you always. Part 1. Bequeath. 1. When Lady Mae went into the kitchen to wash the dishes, she found that her mother had left her kit at home. It sat on her mother's side of the old, worn table, inches from where Lady Mae stood. Though she had been taught from as far back as she could remember that inside the kit were her mother's work tools, the ones for people, in any case. Lately, when Lady Mae found herself in the presence of the kit, there was a knocking at her breast and a speeding in her heart. The kit itself was small and ordinary, no bigger than the book containing Settlement 5's bylaws. Alone, there on the table, the tools inside the kit remained harmless, but in her mother's hands, and soon also her own, they commanded what Lady Mae had taken for respect. And that's what it was, right? The bowed heads, the quiet that fell on the square when she and her mother walked into town. It was absolution, a kind of credence. Her mother had explained it to her over and over. It ain't always like it seems. Right now, it's me. But soon, it'll be you. They don't know no better. Maybe they didn't. Maybe they did. Maybe what they knew was so heavy and frightening that to even look in the direction of it was impossible. And so, when Lady Mae and her mother passed the other residents as they stood still on their porches with brooms in hand, their eyes stayed at the women's feet, lest they let it show. Lady Mae stood next to the table and looked down at the kit. Its forgotten presence in itself did not cause Lady Mae alarm. Perhaps today her mother was only working on the livestock, and the tools she needed, bigger and sharper, were hanging on hooks in the back of the depot by the livestock pen. But if her job that day was an atonement, and her kit was still there in the shack, Lady Mae resolved that she'd bring it to the depot. If her mother had to return to the shack and fetch them, the deputies might come around. They'd been worse lately, too, or so it seemed. But then another thought crossed her mind. In the 17 years she'd been alive, Lady Mae had never disobeyed her mother purposefully. Not once, not ever. But that morning, as the hot wind blew up against the kitchen window, she pulled out her mother's rickety chair and sat down. She dragged the kit toward her, saw the cracked and shredded leather by the clasp. It looked like the skin of a fish salted and left to dry, and Lady Mae ran her fingers along the spine. She would leave her shack shortly and make the walk to the depot, but first she wanted to see what was inside. The clasp was cool on her fingertips. There was no lock and key, no numerical combination to open it up. She simply pressed down on the horseshoe-shaped latch, and it popped open. Lady Mae opened it slowly, and as she did, saw firsthand what she had long known was in there. Small tools, made of shiny metal and buckhorned handles, each in their own sleeve. She lifted out the scalpel. It was heavier than she expected it to be. And though its blade was no bigger than her smallest finger, she was careful. Even without touching it, it was sharp enough to cut through skin and muscle with ease. Lady Mae went from left to right, picking up and examining each tool. The clamp, the saw, the tourniquet, the file, the bone cutter. Each had its own purpose, but there at the table in the mid-morning light, they did not seem big or weighty enough to remove a finger or a hand or an entire leg. How could her mother adequately do her job with such rudimentary tools? How would Lady Mae be expected to do so as well in less than a year? She looked at her hands, and though they were dry and cracked, they were young still. Would they be strong enough?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.